Hey guys, Quiv the Lazy Geek here, and today I want to talk about starting astrophotography the lazy way. And before that, allow me to clarify what I mean by astrophotography, because there are tons of types of astrophotography, and I will be referring to one in particular, which is what I practice the most. Now, the easiest way to get into astrophotography is to use something like a photo tripod and a camera, especially if the camera has an intervalometer function. Like this one doesn't by default. It's a Canon G5X, it's pretty old, but you can actually install the hacked firmware on that to get that function. And then you'll just be putting that on the tripod, directing it to the Milky Way or to the Orion Nebula, take a series of exposures, get in software. So by exposure, I mean like maybe 10 seconds long, 15 seconds long, get in software, align all of that, and then you'll get actually a decent result. But very quickly, and this is fun, and it's a good way to start, but very quickly, you'll start to want more. And this is where the money starts flying out and away from you, and you never recover. So that's one first type of astrophotography, and it's typically like wide field, right? You're using normal cameras, you don't have a huge 200 millimeters, 300 millimeters, 400 millimeters lens on top, and you're just trying to take wide fields of the Milky Way or larger nebulae. So, first way of doing astrophotography. The second way of doing astrophotography is to target things like the moon and planets. Now, the moon is also possible with that previous setup that we had. But with planets, typically, you'll want like Jupiter, Saturn, make excellent and beautiful targets, and they're ever-changing, which is always so much fun to image. You'll want something a bit different. Which is something like this, where you have a fairly large telescope that has, this one is actually a 9.25-inch aperture telescope. It's a Celestron, and it's a big mirror in there that will then be reflected twice, and you can watch from here. And you can attach cameras, and what you do for planetary astrophotography is that typically you're going to take a video of that. Like you can even do that with a modified webcam. And you take a video of your object, the reason being that the sky, the atmosphere, moves around, which means that the planet that you're trying to take into picture is also moving around with the atmosphere. And what you're trying to do is that by taking many frames, so taking a video, you can find automatically the best frames of the lot, the ones that are the most stable, that have the most detail, and then stack them together, and then with some post-processing magic, and it's actually math, you're not inventing anything, you'll be able to actually get an enormous amount of detail out of planetary targets. This type of astrophotography is one of the easiest type to get into if you have bought the equipment, in which you need a tripod, a mount, like this one, which is an alt-as mount, which is great for visual astronomy when you're just watching the stars. And it's also pretty decent for planetary astrophotography, at least for a start. It's one of the most intuitive types of mount, and this one here is an Ioptron AZ Mount Pro, which I think is less than $1,000. So it's still expensive, but it's very powerful. It has GPS, it has GoTo, it will go to the targets automatically, it will track very well, and it's all nice and good. Of course, planetary astrophotography, you can do it with other things. People have done it with what is called Dobsonian telescopes, which are huge, typically huge telescopes. It's just a big mirror on a plate, on a mount that's actually on the ground, and it's typically manual. So then you're trying to get, you're following the target, your planet manually while taking an image of it, and it gets very difficult. But it's a fascinating area of astrophotography, and the only thing that it requires is it requires, of course, skill and patience, but it also requires good seeing conditions. And the seeing is basically how unstable the atmosphere is. If the atmosphere is very unstable, as it is usually the case in Tokyo, then you can do a lot of effort on planetary imaging, but never, I mean, you'll get very good results. It's incredible. I've taken pictures of Jupiter from here, which you can probably see on the screen right now, or Saturn as well. And to me, they're amazing, but from a planetary astrophotographer's perspective, they're mediocre at best, and you'll start wanting more and more. But for me, my conditions here typically don't warrant it. So if you have good seeing, if you have the means to get a telescope like that and a mount like that, or you have the energy, you know, to get a Dobsonian, which are very cheap relative to the aperture, and use that for planetary, it's great. And you can get results that are mind-blowing to me, that are amazing, that can impress all of your friends in a very short frame of time. So you can spend, you know, I can actually use this, spend 10 minutes with it, and get a decent picture of a planet or the moon. And that's completely amazing. There's a variant to this planetary astrophotography, which is solar astrophotography. The most exciting part of that is using H-alpha filters that are not cheap. The cheapest ones are around $1,000 for types of telescopes that are called refractors, basically just like your standard, what you picture to be a telescope, a lens in the front, lens in the back, and it's like the telescopes from, you know, the pirates. And with those, you can actually add something called a quark eyepiece. It's a brand name that can give you details on the surface of the sun, but also on the prominences of the sun, like the explosions of fire that you can see on the sun. It's actually quite fascinating, but it's another like field of astrophotography that's kind of separate from the rest. You would also need a mount like this one, or like the one that I have here. And you would also, this time you would not want to use a mirrored telescope unless you're willing to pay thousands of euros or dollars for having a filter on top of that. You would use a refracting telescope and an H-alpha filter most of the time. You can use also a white light filter. You can get very impressive results as well, but I personally love to see H-alpha pictures of the sun. And I've taken quite a few when I had that, and I'm probably showing some of those while I'm talking now. So that's another side of astrophotography. And this one, it's very forgiving. I really like this type of astrophotography because it's very easy to get into, it's very easy to get results, and doesn't take a lot of time, but it can take a lot of money. It depends on your approach. And then you have another type of astrophotography, and that's the one I'm most into with this setup here, which is deep sky objects astrophotography. And this is basically, I'm going to point this to nebulae, to galaxies, to star clusters, and I want to actually, you know, capture the details. And with planetary imaging, you have very bright targets, so you can spend 10 minutes and get a very decent result. With deep sky imaging, you do not have very bright targets most of the time, so if you want a good result on some of the brighter targets, you can actually get by with just 1 hour of exposure and 1 hour of work if you are in a very dark zone. If you are in a white zone like Tokyo, you have a lot of light pollution and you cannot see many stars when you're looking up at night, then it's going to take much more time and it's going to get more difficult, and there are tons of workarounds to consider. So the main criteria for planetary was the atmospheric conditions. The main criteria, and atmospheric conditions actually play a role in deep sky imaging as well, and especially if you're imaging things like galaxies that require, where you want to get details at the heart of the galaxies, the seeing, so the atmospheric conditions will play a role. But the main factor for deep sky object imaging is typically the light pollution, and it is definitely possible to do it from a white zone. After all, that's what I'm doing. I'm in Tokyo taking astrophotographies of deep sky objects, and that's actually quite fun to do. But this side of astrophotography is probably like the most complex in terms of getting started, because you need a lot of things. And this is kind of an extreme example. You can have a simplified, not simplified I would say, but a miniaturized version of this, where you have a much smaller mount or even a star tracker that can be like the size of, you know, a little box. And you can have, instead of a big telescope like that, a camera lens, like a 200 millimeters Canon or Nikon lens. And connected to that, you can use a DSLR, but I wouldn't recommend that. Or you use like a specific astro camera like this red thing here that can actually be cool to have less noise from the sensor. I'll get into that sooner or later in this series. And so this is just an example of a setup. And you can see, just like before, I have a mount, but unlike this mount, which is out as, which is great for visual astronomy and to some extent for planetary and solar astrophotography, this one is called a German equatorial mount. And there's variations of that. This is one of the more popular mounts for fairly large telescopes, but you can get, as I was mentioning, star trackers. Some of the most popular are from Ioptron or from Vixen, if you want something made in Japan. And on top of that, you have the optical tube. We usually call it OTA for optical tube assembly, if I remember correctly. And you'll have things like filters, you'll have things like an astro camera, you might have a thing like an autofocuser, and you might have a thing like, I have a little scope on top here, which is a guide scope to keep track of the target that I'm imaging. And when you're doing that, I typically take around at least 10 hours, if I can, of exposures of my deep sky objects. And for that, we take lots of small exposures, maybe like between 30 seconds and 10 minutes long, sometimes more, sometimes less. It depends on your equipment, who you are, your conditions, and what you're trying to aim for. Now, there's tons of tutorials about this kind of imaging. And there's tons of tutorials about planetary, and there's tons of tutorials about tripod-based imaging. I'm going to focus on what makes deep sky astrophotography the least painful possible and the least frustrating possible. That's my objective with this series of tutorial. It doesn't mean the cheapest. It doesn't mean the easiest to get into. It doesn't mean the easiest to set up, but it will mean, in the end, the least frustration, the least frustrating type of DSO astrophotography, and DSO is deep sky object. So that's it for an introduction. I hope this gives you already a good idea of what we're going to talk about. So in the next videos, I'll be talking about choosing a mount. I'll be talking about choosing a camera. I'll be talking about choosing filters and maybe a filter wheel. I'll be talking about choosing a focuser. And do you even need a focuser? The answer is yes. Yes, you do. I'll explain why. And at least if you're lazy, you do. And then there's, I'll talk about like guide scopes and how to choose a guide camera. And of course, there's this big tube there, how to choose an OTA. Although, you know, you can typically use what you have lying around. So a lot to cover. We'll do that in some other videos soon. But I hope this is being helpful. I hope that this is something that you want to watch, and I'll keep publishing videos in this tutorial series. So talk to you soon. If you like this video, click like, and also if you can subscribe, that way you can see have notifications about the newer videos that I'm going to post on this tutorial series. And don't forget to look up at the stars whenever you can. See you next time.